Welcome back, everybody. So now we will apply the theorems from the previous hour to the discussion of prime ends. And to simplify the discussion, let me consider bounded domains, but exactly the same will work for unbounded domains. You just consider the spherical metric. Details are exactly the same, and I'll skip them. Okay, so the idea is we're now trying to do seemingly impossible. We are trying to extend conformal map of the disk to the unit circle. So let's see what would happen. And we start with the lemma which is due to Kobe. As we discussed or hinted before, if you have a crosscut in the disk, its image might not be a crosscut, because no, you can start oscillating, and we'll see quite a few examples of this later. But if you have a crosscut in the domain, in the image, its inverse is a crosscut in D. And well, that's essentially easily follows from what we discussed about Krasadori metric. Let's prove it rigorously, of course. Let's take this preimage. And we need to show that the limit when t goes to 0 and 1 exists. That's all we need to show. Remember, crosscut is some arc now in the disk, which needs to land at points of the disk. Suppose that, for example, this limit of preimage of gamma t when t goes to 0 does not exist. So you start oscillating near the boundary of the disk. Well, select two sequences which converge to two different points of the boundary. Well, they need to go to the boundary, but again, we can oscillate near the boundary. By Lavrentiev or other extended version of it, diameter of this curve from Tn to Tn prime is at least z1 minus z2 squared in the limit, because this curve in the limit separates z1 and z2. But of course, this diameter tends to zero. Right? So because this was cross cut. So there was a limit when both tn and tn prime went to zero. So diameter of this tends to And speaking of technical difficulties, I just got disconnected. So let me see. Okay. Okay. We are back. Sorry about this technical difficulty. I promised you in the beginning, remember, that there would be some. That was relatively mild. Even recording didn't stop. So something, I guess, happened with my home internet. But anyway, we just proved lemma of Kirby, which says that preimage of a crosscut is always a crosscut. This leads us to definition of a chain. So in the beginning, chain just exists in the domain. So chain is a collection of crosscuts gamma n, and one of the components of omega minus gamma n, which satisfies the following properties. First, diameter of gamma n tends to zero. And second is that the domains, well, they actually are getting smaller. dn plus 1 is subset of dn. And the, finally, the third condition is that distance between gamma n and gamma n plus 1 is positive. Not only they don't intersect, but the distance is positive. So this collection, for example, this constitutes family of cross-cuspal prime end. This does not, because they kind of land at the same point. Okay, so what is very important here is that we assume that just the diameter of gamma n tends to zero. Diameter of dn can be huge. And actually, in all the non-trivial examples that we would consider, it will be huge. Now, we need a notion of equivalence of chains. So we say that two chains are equivalent if for every n, dn contains all but finitely many dn primes, and for also for every n, dn prime contains all but finitely many dms. So essentially, if you look at every domain defining the crosscut, the same they're essentially the same. And now prime ends would be this equivalency classes of crosscuts. Okay, so first let us try to see why this notion is conformally invariant. And this would be given by this lemma that preimage of a chain under a conformal map is back, is again a chain. And then we'll study prime ends in the unit disk, and surprise, surprise, they will be essentially just points on the unit circle. Okay, so proof is the following. We know that F inverse of this gamma n is cross-cut by Lavrentiev. The diameter of this is bounded by square root of diameter of gamma n. And by Wolf theorem, distance between gamma n and gamma n plus 1 is positive. Again, why is it the case? So here's a little description. So this at gamma n and say gamma n plus 1. And suppose that they approach each other. Then there is a small crosscut which would cut them both. So there are two points which are very close. So there will be a crosscut which would separate these points and would have very small length. But then this crosscut intersects both of these curves. And that's, that means that the distance between them would go to zero, which is a contradiction. So by Wolf lemma, the distance between them is okay. And then now, of course, inclusion relation is preserved. But just take preimage of smaller domains. And of course, equivalency relation, which as described here, is also preserved. So preimage of a prime end is also a prime end. Again, in a moment, we'll see what are the prime ends in the unit disk. Okay, so now the definition. What is the support of prime end? If P a prime end, support of P is just intersection of the closures of the domain DNs. defining the prime end. And of course, this does not depend on chain because of this inclusion relations. Closures eventually one would be inside the other. And that's where we use the fact that the distance between crosscuts is positive. So not only domains are included, but their closures are also included. And of course, this is a compact connected set always, but it's not always a point. And now let me finally do some examples. First example is a mega example. That's actually would be the heart of Cassadori extension theorem that we will prove. That we consider D as our domain. And let us consider any prime end. Then I claim that support of this prime end is one point in the Eden disk. Indeed, because we know that diameter of gamma n tends to zero, distance between endpoints of gamma n tends to zero. So the arc that they bound gets smaller and smaller, and its length tends to zero. Okay, so let me actually separate this picture from this. Okay, so for each prime end, there is a point on the support. More than that, every such prime end is equivalent to natural prime end that you can take. You can just consider, so consider the boundary, consider the point Z, and consider circles of radius 1/n. So if you have a prime end whose a chain rather whose support is Z, then this chain is equivalent to the standard chain where gamma n is simply a crosscut which is part of a circle of radius 1/n centered at Z. Again, because if this because this domain contains a small neighborhood of Z, so and then it contains all the small ones and vice versa. If eventually if your crosscuts would coincide this. Okay, so prime ends. So the whole point of this meta example, probably I should emphasize it. Let me highlight it. But this is very important, also easy example, which shows that on the unit disk, all the prime ends are naturally associated to the points on the unit circle. But of course, in the domains, it could be more interesting. For example, let us start with very simple domain. Let us take unit disk and remove this radius 0/1. Then the same, exactly the same reasoning as what I just stated would tell us that over each point on the interval 0/1, you have two prime ends. One at the top, so chains approach from the top, another at the bottom. So this is very natural. Yes, you have two prime ends here. Okay, finally, an example where I of P is non-trivial. So let us consider domain omega, which is just would be first quadrant, minus all these intervals of length one at 1/j, for all j's. And now, your gamma ends would be joining ends of these intervals somewhere here. Then diameter of this is essentially 1/j, so it tends to zero. diameter of dn here is at least one. So that's what our first example of how prime end can be non-trivial. Again. So this would be your whole, this whole thing is your dn. And again, diameter is not equal to, not tending to zero. And then it's very easy to see that this intersection is just this whole thing. So this prime end corresponds to the interval zero to I. Now let us consider an example which is, I would say, even more drastic. Let's take a quadrant and remove from it first this line of radius 1/2 in the 45 degree direction, then cut it by half and remove lines of length 1/2 and so on. So if argument is odd number over 2 to the n, you remove interval of the length 1 over 2 to the n. Then over 0, you have uncountably many crosscuts. Because to define a crosscut, what you need to do? You, at each moment, you select either left or right crosscut to go further. And so it's the same as selecting one zeros as usual. So over zero, there are uncountably many crosscuts. And this is another drastic example. So here, remember the spiral for Wolff's theorem. So this is unit disk, and then you remove a spiral, which spirals to T. Again, simply connected domain. But then there exists one prime end whose support is the whole unit disk. So what you do, you simply consider crosscuts which are smaller and smaller because you approach unit disk, and the domain's DNs would be smaller and smaller neighborhoods of the unit circle. More than that, similar way, you can draw a second spiral here. And then you would have two crosscuts, which are supported by the whole unit circle. So such things also can happen. Another classical example, well, let me not write the formula, simply you have this comp. So you have these things which go closer and closer to each other. Then support of this crosscut is 0, 1, with the whole interval 0, 1. And here's another way to get the same thing. Support of this prime end is again this whole 0, 1. Because again, we take smaller and smaller distances between the lines constituting the comp. And now we are ready to state what I promised you, this first Karasadori extension theorem. So suppose that F is the conformal map from D to omega, then the correspondence between P and intersection of closures of preimages of Dn, it's a bijection between prime ends and the unit circle. So this is in what sense you have this extension. And then, well, of course, we'll define a matrix. Well, first, of course, we know that F inverse of P is a prime end. So for every P, there exists unique point which is in this intersection. Now, injectivity. Suppose that you have two prime ends which correspond to the same point. What does it mean? That their pre-images are equivalent. Remember, we discussed it, that if any two prime ends corresponding to the same point of the unit circle are equivalent, because again, they are both equivalent to the standard circular prime end. So pre-images are equivalent, take F, they are the same. They themselves are equivalent, so they are done. The map is injective. So the most interesting part is surjectivity. Why would you have for any point, why would you have a crosscut? Take a point Xi and let's find the sequence which converge to this point. Okay, so now there exists a crosscut gamma n such that F inverse of gamma n separates Xi and Z1 from zero. So remember, we by Wolf, we always have a short crosscut, even an image of a circular arc centered at Xi. And the diameter is bounded by constant over log plus of Z1 minus Xi. So, and again, this is a circular arc. Now, by Lavrentiev theorem, this goes to zero because diameter goes to zero, so Rn goes to zero. Now we select sequence Rnk which goes to zero. Then what do we have? We have that this gamma Nk with f of this is a prime end. So again, that's where I use the fact that I can select circular arcs. So I select circular arcs, they go to zero. I select monotone decreasing subsequence, it's still a sequence. And then you just got this gamma nk. Their diameter tends to zero, and they are far away from each other because of the construction. And then we are done. Okay, so that's Karasadori theorem. Let us play with it. There is a rather embarrassing corollary of this. Remember that prime ends are defined purely geometrical. There is nothing conformal about them. Yet there is the statement for which I don't know geometrical topological proof. Suppose that you have two non-equivalent chains. Then at some moment, they would become disjoint. So if two chains are non-equivalent, then starting from some n, dn and dn prime are disjoint. Okay, so again, I don't know how to prove it directly, but in direct proof is trivial. Just pull it back to the unit disk. They are not equivalent, so the pullbacks converge to different points. So of course, for the pullbacks, eventually pullbacks of DN and DN prime would become disjoint because they converge to different points. That's it. But I don't know how to do it without Cross-Hadley theorem. Okay, and now more about this extension. Let's do now metric extension. You consider the set of all prime ends. This is called Karasaya-Dorie boundary of domain omega. And you take omega hat. This is Karasaya-Dorie compactification of domain omega. So you just add boundary. And you define Karasaya-Dorie metric on omega hat to make the compactification. So this is for dumb points in d omega and z2 in omega bar. You can see the shortest crosscut separating z1, z2 from w0. And exactly as before, by Wolf and by Lavrentiev, this map also becomes map with bounded below and above modulus of continuity. So what Karasaya-Dorie theorem says is that essentially this map F hat is gomeomorphism with controlled norm between closed unit disk and Karasaya-Dorie extension. Okay, so now we'll need, when we talk about Lochner chains next, we'll need to talk about very specific type of extension, and that comes from Jordan curves. So the next theorem would say that if omega is a Jordan domain, meaning that d omega is a Jordan curve, let me actually write it here. Boundary of omega Jordan curve. Then there is actually homeomorphism between closed disk to closure of omega, which is just an extension of the conformal map between the unit disk and omega. So in a sense, what I am saying is that I was just trying to convince you that Euclidean is not good, but Euclidean is not good for general domains. This theorem tells us that even in Euclidean metric, everything is good. But of course, there is no controlled moduli of continuity. That's why even in Jordan for Jordan domains, I would prefer to consider Karasaya-Dorie metric. But again, this continuity up to the boundary would be very important because that would allow us to define F or F inverse at the points of the boundary, which is by itself is great. Okay, so of course we have Karasaya-Dorie theorem. So first thing that we need to check to apply Karasaya-Dorie theorem and get this, the second Karasaya-Dorie theorem. First, we need to check that support of every prime end is a single point. So let us check this. So we have this gamma n. It's a crosscut. It joins alpha tn with alpha tn prime. And of course, we know that diameter of gamma n tends to zero. That means that alpha tn minus alpha tn prime tends to zero. Because now alpha is a parametrization of our boundary, which is homeomorphism. So tn minus tn prime also tends to zero. And limit of alpha and tn and alpha and tn prime should be the same, because the distance tends to zero, it's I of p. Can we use the fact that there is a parameterization of every Jordan curve, which is homeomorphic. Now we need to show that every point is of the boundary is I of P for some point for some prime end. That's also very easy. We take Xi in the boundary. We look at the disk of radius one of n centered at Xi, intersected with omega, and we look at the component which contains Xi on the boundary. Of course, intersection of the closures is Xi. Now, where was the crosscut? The crosscut was exactly the part of the boundary of this, which contained, which again was boundary of the n. So let me write it here, that gamma n would be boundary of the n minus gamma n would be boundary of the n minus boundary of omega. Okay, so that's also easy. And so now we get Carasadori theorem simply by applying previous Carasadori theorem. Now, amazingly enough, this same proof works in slightly more general situation, but the result is weaker. So let me be very precise here. Suppose that omega is such that boundary is locally connected. So locally connected means that for every epsilon, there exists delta such that if we have two points on the boundary, and they are delta close, then there exists a crosscut. Well, a connected subset of the boundary such that Z1 and Z2 are at this connected subset, and diameter is less than epsilon. So it says that any two points which are close enough in Euclidean metric can be made close enough in intrinsic distance of the boundary. By the way, by this statement, any Jordan curve is locally connected, just by this discussion, because again, you have homeomorphism. Now, what the theorem is, that every conformal map extends to the boundary. More than that, it extends to the boundary if and only if boundary is locally connected. So continuous image of the circle, it's really easy to see that it is locally connected. So one direction is clear, and then the other direction is again the same application of Carasadori theorem with exactly the same proof. And by the way, it shows that why for such domains, Carasadori metric and Euclidean metric are comparable. Maybe with huge constants. And again, more than huge constants, they're not Lipschitz to each other. The gauge function between them could be horrible. We just know that if one tends to zero, then the other tends to zero. But that's all we know for locally connected domains. Okay, so this is actually what we will use when we study Loebner chains. We will use this remark. Okay, and now we are ready to move finally closer to what we really need. We are ready to move to Lerner Revolution. And of course, I tried to collect all the results in that we would need in geometric function theory in the previous lecture and then a previous part of today's lecture. But of course, it's impossible to do everything. So here, a few more things that we would need, but they're rather easy. First is the notion of subordination. That would be crucial to our understanding of Lerner chains. So suppose that you have two functions which are analytic in the unit disk. I'm not saying that F is conformal. I just know that G is conformal. F is just analytic. We say that F is subordinated to G if you can find a phi which maps unit disk to itself, such that essentially F is the restriction of G. So G composed with phi. So phi is an analytic map from the unit disk somewhere to a smaller part of it, not necessarily conformal, just analytic. Okay, then equivalently, from geometric point of view, it just means that image of F is subset of image of G, and they have at zero, they're the same. And the proof is just you consider phi to be G inverse composed with F. So if they're both conformal, as we would have later, then it just means that F maps to smaller domain. That's all. Okay, so some consequences of subordination, which are really easy. Since phi of Z is less than Z, and F is G composed with phi, image of every disk of radius R is subset of image of every disk of radius R under G. Because again, your every point, so to define a map here, you apply to some point from the disk here, because phi of Z decreases the size. Second is that because phi prime at zero is less or equal than one, F prime is less or equal than G prime, of course. Now, by Schwarz lemma, we know that this is true, that phi prime divided by one minus phi squared is bounded by one minus one over Z squared, and the quality is reached only when you have Möbius map. Remember, that was one of the statements, conformally invariant, rather invariant statements of Schwarz. And so this means that maximum of one minus Z squared F prime of Z is bounded by maximum one minus Z squared G prime of Z. So if each of them is bounded, then the other, so if this is bounded, then this one should be bounded too. And you can also do it inside of this, of course, because one is mapped to the other. Second object that we would need is a class of analytic functions now. So we used to talk, that's why this is a separate discussion. We now talk about analytic functions, not necessarily conformal. And we say that analytic function belongs to class P if it's subordinated to 1 plus Z over 1 minus Z. 1 plus Z over 1 minus Z is a map from the unit disk to the right half plane, which maps 0 to 1. So the statement is that it just means that P is a function with positive real part and which maps 0 to 1. That's all. of the conditions about P. Okay, so let's see what our subordination results give us. Well, first is that we have this, that P of Z is bounded above and below by 1 minus Z, 1 plus Z, 1 plus Z over 1 minus Z. Again, this is just because of subordination. And the fact that 1 over P of Z is also in P, of course. Second is that P prime of Z, again, by this discussion, is bounded by 2 over 1 minus Z squared. So P is locally bounded, so it is normal. Again, very important observation for us that functions with fixed image of zero and positive real part actually form a normal family. Now, very important property, Hergloss representation of function P. So every function in P can be represented as this Hergloss integral for some probability measure on the unit circle. And vice versa, of course. If you have such representation, it's very easy to see that you are in class P. And another very important property. What is the support of P? The support of mu rest. Support of this measure mu would be closure of the set on the unit circle where real part doesn't tend to zero. So this is, again, if a student of mine in calculus course would write it, I would take off many points, but well, we are not in calculus. So this means that maybe the limit doesn't exist, but it surely does not equal to zero. So, well, okay, so rigorous way to write it, okay. Be pedantic, I don't know why. Since it's positive. So this is supported on the set where the real part does not converge to zero. The proof is trivial. We just write Poisson representation for real part of P. It's harmonic, positive harmonic function. So it has Poisson representation. And then take imaginary part, take conjugate. And we just know that the conjugate at zero is zero, because P of zero is very much real and equal to one. And then to see that the measure mu is probability, again, real part P of zero, it's still equal to one, and this is the total mass of the measure. So this is just, this Hergloss representation is consequence of Poisson representation. And finally, this is also consequence of Poisson representation, because if you have an open interval where real part of P tends to zero, of course, Poisson measure doesn't see this set. Okay, so now, great moment, I can start rigorously define not yet stochastic, deterministic Lerner chains. And so, let me start with radial Lerner chains. I call them classical. Well, they're not quite classical, unfortunately. So what Lerner considered was slightly different way to state it, but it's one can be easily obtained from the other. So Lerner, he worked with class S. So he considered Lerner chains from functions in class S, essentially. So you needed some growing family of domains. Here, I will adapt to what we will need for Schramm-Lerner evolution. And so this is a radial version of this. And so this is definition of non-normalized Lerner chain first. So this would be a collection of conformal mappings of the unit disk such that when you are bigger, when t2 is bigger than t1, f of t2 is subordinate to f of t1. Then second is that ft of z is continuous on t, uniformly on compact for every z. So for every t, for every fixed t, you have a conformal map. They are mapping to smaller and smaller domains. And then the first map should be just identity. And then, so which means that in particular that f0 of 0 is equal to 0, that means that all of them map 0 to 0 because of this subordination. But what I also want, I want that at the end, when t goes to infinity, they collapse to 0. So this is called non-normalized yet Hilmer chain. So we'll normalize it in a moment. Now, of course, we can define it in terms of the image of omega t and ft. Well, they should all contain zero because zero is mapped to zero. Now, if t2 is bigger than t1, domain is smaller. This is equivalent to, so these two things are equivalent to one. Now you start with d, this is equivalent to this. And zero, well, so here actually I made a mistake. Zero does not belong to the interior of the intersection of omega t's, which means that eventually they squeeze out zero. That's why we have. So with respect to zero, in Cassiodorian sense, they would converge to just zero. And then this is this continuity statement that the map t to omega t is Cassiodorian continuous with respect to t. Remember, we had last week, we had geometric characterization of exactly this uniform and compact convergence of conformal maps. This all comes together now. Okay, so this is non-normalized Lerner chain, two definitions in terms of conformal map, in terms of squeezing sequence of domains. What would be very important is to look at the complement of omega t. This would be growing subsets of the unit disk, which we call halves. When we consider chordal case, they will be even more important than this. Okay, so now let us look at the main example of such non-normalized Lerner chain. Slit domain. We consider continuous map from zero infinity to the unit disk, such that gamma at infinity is zero. So you're supposed to land at zero. Gamma of zero is on the disk and outside, on the circle rather, and outside of zero, you are in the disk. So this is a curve going from boundary to zero. Now, omega t would be just complement of the curve run up to time t. It satisfies all the conditions here. Zero belongs to omega t. They are getting smaller. Omega zero is d, and zero is not in the interior of the intersection. Because the intersection again would be just this intersection of omega t's would be just complement of our curve gamma and zero. But zero is not in this interior, so this is satisfied. And finally, Cassiodorian continuity is easy here. Every time you add a small, so every time you go further, you add a small interval, a small arc. And when you go back, it's very easy to see that what you add, again, is just converges in Kerr-Feder sense. So, well, you can pick the interior approximation or kernel convergence, whatever you prefer. It's very easy to check here. Now, KT, of course, this growing family of Hulls would be just the curve itself. Okay, so this is it's time for another break. Let's take a break for now. And let's after the break, I will continue discussing Lerner chains and we'll finally normalize them. For now, let me stop the recording.